People like agendas, and I'm not great at them. So I tried to put this into three parts. So there's going to be an overview. There's going to get familiar with teams, and we're going to get to know Sakai, which is our learning management system. Those are the three main things I'd like you to leave with today. Hopefully we can meet your needs. And if not, we can definitely answer some questions at the end. Yep, go ahead. Next slide. So I just wanted to, for anybody who wasn't at the welcome session, I just want to remind you that this is just a kickoff of TA Days, that there is a whole week of amazing programming available on our website. I've put that CPI at Brock U email because that's if you have any technical issues, if you're experiencing, we learn about some things and how they're working here today, and you're like, this isn't working, my video's not loading, my browser is blah blah blah, any of those issues, please email CPI Brock U. We have a whole team of educational technologists who can support you. As you can see at the bottom of that screenshot on the website, that EdDev is your contact, which is Natalie and Leanne and Anne, who are in the welcome session, who will be responding to anything to do with your pedagogical and to do with certificates and related to the TA program. But if you have any technical issues, especially related to your courses, please reach out to CPI at Brock U. Next slide.
Sorry, I'm trying to multitask into the attendance before I forget.
No problem. We do have a lot more people than we're registered. So it's a good thing we're taking live attendance. I will make a note, actually. I'll just take a meta moment here to describe how attendance works. A lot of you might be responsible for doing synchronous sessions using Teams, maybe in seminars or labs, and you will be asked to take attendance. Only the person who organizes the event can actually take attendance. In that case is Natalie. So I, even though I'm a co-presenter in this session, only one person can really be the organizer, and that's the person who's created the event, and only that person can download the attendance sheet. It's definitely a limitation. So it's something that we want to talk about. I'm not going to get into the nitty-gritty of creating meetings, but we're happy to support you through those steps as you move forward if you do have these seminars set up. But let's take a step back and just talk about what the difference is. What am I even talking about, synchronous and asynchronous? This is kind of like the biggest question we've been getting, and it's been not exactly evenly applied across the university. So we're kind of, you know, wayfinding as we go. So synchronous is real time. What we're doing right now is a synchronous event. It's usually some kind of a video conferencing tool. At Brock, we use Teams or LifeSize. The tool Zoom, I'm sure all of you have heard of, is what is, you know, kind of the industry standard, but Brock doesn't have that. So it's funny, it's being used as, you know, like Kleenex instead of tissue, people Zoom. But we don't technically have the actual tool called Zoom at Brock. So depending on your faculty and your department, there are people, pockets of people using Zoom with their own personal licenses, but CPI can't support Zoom specifically because it doesn't have an institutional license. So we're using Teams. This is the tool. And there is LifeSize as well, which is a more historically, we've had it throughout the years. But I find that Teams is a little more substantial at this point. And so by comparison, there are asynchronous courses happening and workshops. So we're trying to model the difference between what's being done live in a real time. You all have to be here at 10 a.m. It's a synchronous versus asynchronous, which is going to start today. And then you have all week to kind of finish on your own time and go into. And that's done in the learning management system. And at Brock, we use Sakai as our learning management system, which is an open source tool. At other institutions, there's other tools being used, but Western and Brock both use Sakai. The key to a successful asynchronous is having explicit deadlines. And so that's something we'll talk about a little bit later. But basically, those are the two main differences between what's happening. And I just want to show you what that looks like in the timetable. Natalie, if you could go to the next slide.
Sure can.
Unless there's anything you want to add to, I just keep blabbing.
No, that's okay. Sorry. Okay. I forgot your images are...
They add these things. Okay, so in the timetable, and I put a link to it because a lot of people weren't really sure where this was being reported, but back in the summer, people instructors and departments had to decide whether they were going to be synchronous or asynchronous. So here's an example of English 1F91, which says it's synchronous. And a D1 means that it's an F course. It's going to go from fall all the way into the winter. And then there's different seminars or lectures associated with it. So this one says that they're synchronous lectures. And if you can go to the next one, here's one that's a history course, and it says that the seminar is asynchronous. And so that can take many different forms. And so we're noticing that there's a lot of flexibility in what's happening there. So we just want to let you know what students will be expecting and where they're getting the information of whether they signed up for synchronous or asynchronous. But ultimately, people are kind of adjusting and trying to do this in a flexible way. A lot of the people who have asynchronous seminars are doing their things on Sakai, the learning management system, like we mentioned, but they're going to have live drop-in hours or office hours. And so then being a little bit familiar with Teams like you are in here today is going to be really useful and helpful to you. So I just wanted to let you know where that information is coming from, and but how it's being enacted in the courses is a little bit different across campus. So we're happy to talk through how it's being done in your particular course. And we've been working with a lot of instructors all through the summer on how they envision it. So it's we're definitely seeing a whole spectrum of possibilities. Next slide, please. So whether you're doing synchronous or asynchronous, we really do like to think about this as being an opportunity to build a community of inquiry. And this means that you're not just talking about content and putting it all up. That's like on this Venn diagram is the cognitive presence. You know, this is, and this we talk about no matter what, whether it's when they're face to face or if we're online. But this becomes actually more possible in online environments where we can balance these connections. So there's a lot of the social presence. So we're all in this room right now. You guys are just listening to me talk. You know, as I ramble on, but we're going to hopefully give opportunities for you to also talk and engage. And so there's this social presence, and that's part of setting climate. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that as well, and giving opportunities to support discourse so you can have some conversations, because we know that content alone is just, you know, the internet is a vast and wonderful place, and there's lots of material to read online, but we want to give opportunities to connect what you know, connect with other people, and actually have conversations. And so a lot of people were confused when we moved to fully online. They're like, but what will I do? I'm the teacher. And it's like, you are so important. And that's that bottom circle. That's the teaching presence. That is what makes or breaks an online course, is your ability to be present. And that doesn't necessarily need to mean that you're in a live session synchronously. It's being available and reliable and consistent. So you set up expectations of when you're going to be able to answer emails or questions, or whether it's in the forums, however the format of interaction will be, you set up expectations and you meet it. And then you're starting to build this climate where they know that they can trust you and come to you for help and answers. That doesn't mean that you're available 24/7. By all means, you need to set very clear guidelines. As we bring the school into our homes, we want to make sure to set very clear boundaries so that you're not just allowing it to take over your entire life. But also you want to make sure that you're available and you can connect on the times that you say that you will be able to, and then you stick to it. So that is the key component to really building a community of inquiry, is that teaching presence. It's really important. Obviously, the other things are very important as well, but it's more than just delivering content. We don't want to just have a content dump. And so there's a lot of literature on that. And so I provided that link for you if you want to read more about the community of inquiry, which has typically always been done in an asynchronous discussion forum, but it can happen obviously in many different ways.
Can I add something? Is that okay?
Please do.
I think that Julia's point that, you know, having that balance in terms of creating a schedule and sticking to it, and also just setting those expectations is really important. And I think when we add the layer of our current COVID reality, we also need to think about the ways that sometimes we need to be flexible as well in setting those expectations with our students. So of course, you'll be at your office hours unless you know, we're living in a pandemic reality unless something happens, right? And setting that expectation with your students that we need to be reliable, but also flexible with one another and empathetic, sort of more, is really important in this time. That's all. There we go.
Okay, so this has become one of the most important graphs that have been shared. You might have seen it on Twitter. It may really made the rounds in social media because bandwidth is actually a huge consideration as far as access. So I'm hoping that this is all coming through clearly to all 74 people in this room right now, and that there's no hiccups or disconnection, and you could hear and see everything okay. But we've been finding that this is not evenly distributed across all of our students. Even faculty and TAs are not do not have equal bandwidth access. So when designing or when using, we're asking to build with this flexibility in mind, and we just wanted to kind of map out where what the tools are at Brock based on these kinds of this quadrant. So if you look at a high bandwidth, which is that, and high immediacy, which is that red quadrant in the top right, that's what we're doing right now. We're doing a high bandwidth, high immediacy activity. It's synchronous, we're using Teams. And so it definitely has its place. It's awesome that we can all be here right now, but it may not be the thing that you use all the time. And so having these fallbacks and other plans can be very helpful. So that brings us over to the left quadrant, which is high bandwidth but low immediacy. A lot of people are using a tool called Echo, which is a third-party video streaming tool that lives inside Sakai. I know that's a lot of gobbledygook kind of language, but basically we have a video server. It's our own private YouTube that lives inside of Sakai. And so instructors and even students, depending on if there's assignments and TAs, can create videos and upload them right inside Sakai in many of the tools. So like the forum tool, the assignment tool, announcements, all of these things can be built right in so that you can do quick little videos that people can access on their own time. And so a lot of the instructors have been working all summer to create their videos as per their lectures, and they've been doing it so that students can access it on their own time. The best thing about this video streaming tool like YouTube is that it will measure its bandwidth based on the device that you're using. So it will, if you have a mobile device or if you're on a laptop, and if you're at a low, if you have low bandwidth, it actually gauges it. So even though I have it in this high bandwidth category, it can be high bandwidth. So I'm on a high speed internet with a big computer. It's using lots of internet when I watch it, but I'm also getting it in nice high resolution compared to if I was doing it on my phone and if I was on my cell signal out in the world. Do I see a hand up? Oh no, somebody was in the waiting room. And then finally, a lot of the activity will be happening asynchronously in Sakai, which is that green quadrant in the bottom left. All right, so in the forums, using discussion boards. And discussion boards are, a technology that's been around since the 90s. And Sakai, kind of has a 90s feel, but you can add other things, which we'll show you as well. But, using text-based discussion or multimodal discussion on an asynchronous but with explicit deadlines can still be really engaging and meaningful. And finally, I want to just bring it over to the high immediacy and low bandwidth, which actually doesn't always need to be done as high immediacy. We're gonna play around with a little bit of some of the collaborative opportunities that are available through Office 365, depending on if you're at another school. Google Docs, all of the Google Suite, very similar. It's just that multiple people can work on the same document at the same time. And if you were setting up explicit deadlines, like, okay, we're going to do this in 10 minutes, which is something we'll show you later, then you can all work on that document at the same time and have something complete, add your ideas. So it's a way to be interactive, but it's still pretty low bandwidth. It's not requiring us all to have our cameras on and microphones on, and I'm not streaming video and images to you. So it's really important for you to see these as quadrants and try and balance out the opportunities of when when you use what. Now, a lot of times, because this has already been designed in the course, you're not going to have that much flexibility. But to know that these other things exist, if so you have a backup plan, that will be really useful to know. So we just want to take you through the full spectrum of what's possible, and so that you can know what can happen. You may not see it in a particular course that you're TAing, you might see it something where you're a student, or you might see it in something that you want to try on your own. So we just want to give you the full spectrum. Okay, so we do want to let you know, technology will fail. It's inevitable. And so I almost did the Douglas Adams, don't panic, because really the key thing we want you to take away is that it's not always going to go perfectly, and that's okay. There's going to be challenges. So let's just from the outset know that there's going to be challenges. Technology is really unpredictable, and we are kind of at the mercy of, like, this tool is a Microsoft tool that is being used across the world in many different contexts. We're not their only client. And so when there's a bug in the tool, they don't rush to fix it for us, because we're just one of their many, many clients. So we have to live with some sort of unpredictable elements. In particular, Teams, like we were saying at the beginning, keeps changing things, mostly for the better. The live captions is something that happened over the summer. Now we can see 49 people on screen. If we all turned our camera on, we can do that. There's some really great things that have happened that are good, and they're always iterating towards good. But there are things that, you know, you're like, why does it do that? And the question is, who knows? Let's just try, and I call it the Roomba method. Just like, oh, that didn't work. Let's just keep trying other things. But we do want to let you know that CPI is here to support. So please reach out if there's something that you're like, oh my gosh, this is really supposed to work. You said this was going to work and it's not working. Please let us know, and we'll try and support you along the way. But the other key point here is that this is new for everybody. The stress over the summer of people being like, oh my gosh, I have to learn. Not only do I have to do all this, and now I have to learn all these new things. This is new for everybody. So let's just be patient and caring with each other and have empathy in that situation. There's the Roomba, exactly. The other thing related to Teams that I should mention is that depending on your operating system, depending on your browser, and depending on if you're logged in, it will be slightly different. And that's going to happen with your students as well. It's unfortunate. I wish I could just say, this is what it looks like. But I have met with people who are using Linux on a Mac, on a PC, who are using Chrome or Firefox or Safari. I'll just say right now, Safari is hugely problematic. So please don't use Safari for anything. I hate saying that, but because it's kind of the default for your, if you're on a mobile device. On an iOS device, the experience is so problematic. Anyway, that will vary depending. So the biggest solution is always try another browser or get the app if possible. Nally, you were like, how can we prepare for these challenges? Do you have some good advice on that?
Yeah, I think that, you know, all we can do is sort of mitigate the challenges. We're all on and students particularly, but we're all on a pretty steep learning curve, and it's ongoing, right? So one of the things I think we can do to sort of lessen or address these challenges is just have conversations and keep those lines of communication open. Talk with our students around expectations. If they can't access a synchronous event, so if you're required to host synchronous seminars and your students are having trouble getting on, what do we do? Like, is there another way for them to demonstrate their engagement, their participation? How do they do that? How do they reach you? If you can't get on to your seminar because you're having bandwidth struggles, have a conversation with your students around, you know, there's a little bit of an urban myth that travels that, you know, if your TA isn't there in 4.5 minutes, then you can leave. Right. So just having these conversations with students that, you know, if someone's having trouble accessing, what are the ways that we can engage in this community process of learning together in a way that doesn't leave people out because they're facing technical challenges? How can we still continue to teach and learn together? So this is something to think about. And there's no perfect answer, unfortunately. No. And it will vary according to what you're teaching, and also your instructor preferences, because your instructor yeah. might have very specific requirements or preferences. But the main thing I think we're getting at here is just that we're all dealing with new challenges, and if we can just enact sort of a pedagogy of kindness and empathy, then that's going to be helpful as we all move forward across the term. Anything to add?
No, I think that's reasonable.
Okay.
Okay, this is our new exciting thing we're going to try. And I have like a big warning there, because depending on if you're logged in or not, you may not see all of these things. So in your Teams interface, you hopefully at the left, you would see this menu bar that has activity, chat, Teams, calendar. If you do not see that, can you raise your hand? I'm going to assume everybody can see that. And what we've done, we have created breakout channels. And
you all can right, access... maybe let's go take Madame Gizé.
In the breakout channels, you can click on that by going to Teams. You find your TA Days team that all of you should be a member of. And then you'll see that we have created, first of all, there's channels for all of the different faculties where you'll find access to all of those drop-in sessions that will be happening through the week. No, don't go there today. Right now, we're going to ask you to choose one of the channels. Don't go yet. because in there, we've created a breakout activity. And what we'd like you to do is we're going to take 10 minutes to go, but wait, don't do it yet. I want to describe what we're going to be doing, which is the next slide first, and then we'll go back to show you how to do it. So the 45 people who registered, I put into groups. We have 76 people, so we're going to have to, just find a room. It's fine. We were going to originally, choose your favorite color and go into one of the groups. I had designed a very great activity where we were going to have you select into a group, but we thought this might be simpler since everybody had registered. But, you got to prepare for challenges like 76 people come to your 46 people workshop. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about the importance of building community. And one of the activities that we recommend, and this is when you're in the face-to-face class or online, is that you build with your students some ground rules of community. James has already left and gone and done that. It's hilarious because we can see you do that. That's really funny. So anyway, don't go yet. Come back. And so in that meeting, when you go in there and join that group, that's where you're going to have a discussion, and we're going to have you report back. So please pay attention to what happens during that time. It's okay, Rahima. It is very confusing. This is being an online TA workshop session, but we didn't restrict access to the meeting because we're not gatekeepers that way. So it's fine.
It's great.
It's fine. I'm so excited to have all 76 of you. I just don't have you on a list. I'm sorry. So Rahima, just choose a color and go into one of the groups.
Yeah. So if you're not on this list, just choose your favorite color. Head into, nope, because we didn't label them colors. So just choose a breakout room and join the conversation. So the first person who gets in the breakout room, do we have a screenshot for this, Julia?
Yeah, go back one. So you can choose breakout channel 1, 2, 3, or 4. And you're going to go in there. You're going to join the meeting.
Right. Sorry, forgot we did it this way.
Just 1, 2, 3, or 4. The color's on the next slide, which it's not relevant. You just choose a color, just choose a group.
There we go.
Laura. This is exciting, the chaos that is ensuing. Good. People are starting to meet.
I have a question.
Yes.
I wasn't added to... I'm Sophia. I'm in group 4, I see. I wasn't added to the team.
To the team?
Yeah.
Okay. So you don't see... So when you go to teams, you don't see the TA days. No. I'm going to try and add... I'm going to add you right now.
Okay.
There we go. Sorry, that's a manual process for this team. If it's your class and your instructor has had those teams, what we call provisioned, then your seminar roster will be put in your team. Those sorts of things are automatic. In this example, like in our TA Days team, we added everyone, all 240 people, by typing in your email addresses. So there are bound to be some mistakes. So...
I'm adding all of you now. No problem. Francis, I'm adding you. Where did you go? Wait, I saw your name somewhere.
And so, yeah. So in the breakout rooms, when you get there, there's a meeting. So just join that meeting. And then you're going to talk about this building of community ground rules really addresses the question, how do we face these technical challenges that people are going to be encountering this year. So have a conversation in that group around what sort of things you might include in a community ground rules agreement with your students, and what are some of the important things that you can do to create a community in your online class this year as a TA. So anyone who can go to a breakout room, we're going to probably welcome you to do so now. And we're going to return back in 10 minutes, we said, Julia?
Yes. We're going to and get you.
Yeah, we're going to come get you.
Or just stay here. Feel free to stay here and we can talk through it. Because I'm seeing a lot of people aren't seeing it, which is fine. Just stay here if you can't see it. Because you may not, as I said... depending on your browser, you may not see the breakout sessions. So Hila, okay, I'm trying to add some. So Nabin, I see you in the team. So you're in there. So I'm not sure why you're not seeing it. It might be the way that you're logged in.
And the meeting that we're in right now is a separate window than the Teams meeting that you'll see, depending on how you're logged in. So if you're using the app, there'll be a window for the meeting that we're in, and then there'll be another team sort of window with like this screenshot that Julia has shared.
Leave that one up for now.
Yeah.
So you should see Teams. You should be able to click on TA Days as your team, and then you should see the breakout channels.
And there you go. So I see that those meetings are happening in the breakout channels now, which is great. So people are there. So if you can't get into that room, that's totally fine. Just stay here.
And Laura is saying that she had to say show hidden channels, which we didn't hide them, but you know, teams apparently hid them on you. So try that if that's a thing that you can try. Yeah, I see that nobody's in channel 3 right now. And I see a lot of hands up. So if those are people who raise their hands because they don't see it, please stay here and we can have a discussion in this room.
Yeah. And it's interesting, Julia, because I see 6 people in room 3. Yay, teams. I actually had to unhide the channels as well, Julia. So if there's 3 dots beside something that says hidden channels, if there's 3 dots, you can select them and you can hit show team or show channel rather. So. Interesting experiences that vary wildly from person to person. The pros and cons. So if you're still here, we have a fair number of people on hold. So that's good. That means that they're in the breakout rooms.
I'm just reading all these things. Oh, yeah. So it definitely, you need to be logged in to see the full, to be able to see the full team's experience. Being logged into your Brock account certainly helps, which is some of the tech support that people are doing. It's okay if this doesn't work, but it is important for us to kind of go through why things don't work. And these are one of the reasons. So browsers, and if you're logged into your Brock account. And if there's chat going on in here, I'll just check.
So if you I can see it,
go on over.
Yeah. So, but not the faculty listed rooms, the workshop breakout channels. So go into the workshop breakout channel versus the, there won't be anyone in the faculty channels yet because we don't have any drop-in sessions happening at this moment. So the workshop breakout channels.
Does anybody have their hand up who wants to say something? I just want to make sure that that's not a, like, you're not a question. Sam, just stay here then if you don't see any channels, it's okay.
So any questions?
What we did want to talk about was the importance of building community and doing and having ground rules. The summary we'll be sharing back, hopefully collaboratively. This might be chaos as well, I feel.
That's okay. We'll give it a go. And the larger the group, the larger the chaos, right? So generally speaking, if you want to try something in a seminar class, it might be sort of more doable if you only need to navigate, you know, half the class go in the breakout room, the other class stay here. So we have more people here than we anticipated, so it's a little bit different, but that's okay. Totally fine. So let's have a conversation, though, about what are some of the things that we need to do in our classes to build that community with a sort of thought in mind that there are some new challenges that we face in the online teaching and learning world, the virtual classroom, if we will. So feel free to unmute and just hop on into that conversation, share some things that you think are really important to building community in your class.
I would say start with ice breaking.
Mm-hmm.
Let everybody introduce themselves to the others. That's a good start for any seminar, I think, and then they can put a face to a name. What do you think, Natalie?
Yeah, thanks, Sam. I think that's, you know, those are always some of the things that we talk about commonly in that first class, right? And there's a whole asynchronous workshop happening on what to do in the first week in the first class where some of these things are going to be talked about. So if you're curious about some introduction activities and community building activities that you could do, please do participate in that workshop for specific strategies. But I think that that's a really important point for sure. I see another hand up as well.
Yes, it's me, Simon. You can hear me?
We can, yeah.
Okay. Hi. I actually probably missed the 9:30 program. I just slept in, and when I turned it on, this meeting was going on, which I tried to sign up, but yesterday the sign up was full. And when I clicked it, it just made me enter through this thing. But I had a list of questions here, which I wanted to know because it's kind of confusing. We are doing it first time to go through this all online thing. And I registered for 4 asynchronous workshops. So it says that for asynchronous workshops, you have to go to Sakai. So how is it going to happen? Like if a workshop time is from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. So are they going to put some videos over there? Or how are we going to access those resources?
Yeah, so yeah, we'll stay around when we're when done, we're this, done workshop this workshop in a bit, and we'll address those questions. But we'll try to focus the conversation now on some of the things that we can do to build community in our classroom. But stay around when we're done, we'll help you get into the Sakai sites that you are interested in. No problem. I saw a couple more hands. Jerry and Susan. Did you want to?
Okay, I'll go. I'm curious more about, maybe you'll be going into this, about how to do the sharing screen, so that if I'm doing that, Now, I'm not sure if that fits in with building community. I think so, but I'm not sure exactly if I wanted to share my screen, what all is shared, so that if I'm kind of concerned that maybe some of something maybe I don't want to have shared, and I just want to have it focus on whatever it is that I do want to share.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and well, I mean, that's kind of related to community building, because if you you want to know when you want to share your screen and don't want to share your screen, and in what ways that can support community building or not, and, you know, is there an opportunity for your students to share content as well? But certainly we'll talk about that a little bit later as well, because the other groups are just going to head back with some of their ideas around how we can build community and ground rules in our class to help us navigate this challenging time. So I'd love to get some ideas around what we can do to support that. Jerry, I see your hand is up. Did you want to unmute? Not quite. That's okay. You're welcome to make your contribution in the chat as well. So Sam's shared with us that, you know, those ice breaking activities are really important. Julia shared with us a little bit earlier that, you know, having those expectations around when you'll be available for communication and when you won't is really important. When we all exist in this Teams platform now, and we all have this chat feature, so it's actually pretty easy for students to find us and to reach out to us. And if you download the app on your phone, it can turn into a pretty consistent stream, I'll call it, of messages. So we want to be really clear with the sort of when you're going to be expecting yourself to answer those messages and when you expect students to answer messages, because we also want to be really cognizant of the fact that we're all teaching and learning in this pandemic, and we want to make sure that we're supporting wellness and supporting that work-life balance as much as is possible. So I think that's a really important consideration as well. Julia, I'm not sure if you were you heading over to tell folks to head on back. She might be on hold because she's doing that. But that's okay. Julia is on hold, which means she's gathering folks back to come and share their conversation points here. So when folks return, for those of you who haven't been able to find that other channel, if you're able to find this screen that's showing on the PowerPoint right now, we'll want to click on this general channel. So we'll still be in our meeting, but you'll be in a different window, and you'll be in the general channel. And that's where we're going to do some collaborative document building here. Okay, so is everyone able to find that, or raise a hand if you have a question about how to access that? And again, depending on how you've accessed the meeting, this may or may not be something that is available to you. So depending on if you've signed in, if you're using the app, which browser, which device, all of these complicating factors. So it's really important. So as we do this collaborative document building with folks when they return to the group, I will be talking about it, right? So folks who can't see the document quite yet will still know what's happening and will still be able to access the information, albeit in a different way. And that's a really important consideration as we all do these sorts of things together. So I'm hopeful that folks will start joining us back. And I'm just going to put some messages in the chat. To welcome folks back to the general channel. It's nice to see several people have been able to join those breakout groups. So that's awesome. There we go. And there is so many moving parts when you're doing these sorts of things. It is going to take a little bit of time to get through. So Rahima, you have another question? Sure, go ahead. Feel free to unmute or put it in the chat, whichever works for you. Will you be able to access the PowerPoint after the meeting ends? Yeah, we can share the PowerPoint after the meeting ends for sure, because that can be helpful.
So my question is, because I registered for TA days, but I guess this workshop wasn't automatically included, will I still get the credit or no?
Yeah, if you participate in the workshop, we will do the credit for you, absolutely. We just did try to limit the registration for this workshop so that we could facilitate this breakout group in a little bit of a smaller group, but that's totally fine. We're happy to have everyone here, and we want to share the information with as many folks as we can.
Okay, and then my last quick question is, on TA days, there's several events for different faculties. If I'm, for example, just like if I'm working for sociology, will I be allowed to access a workshop for like health sciences or no?
I mean, you can absolutely if you think it'll be meaningful to you. That's one of the things we try to do in the CPI programming, is it's sort of a choose your own adventure in that you choose the workshops and events that are meaningful to you and that you believe will support the work that you do. So feel free to attend things. And some folks teach in a different faculty or in a different department than they're doing the graduate studies in, or that they have roles across different faculties. So certainly we're not trying to gatekeep any of these things. So not a problem at all. No problem. So we'll answer some of these questions around the details of the workshop credits as the folks get back. I'm hopeful that folks are heading back to this larger meeting now.
Yeah, I jumped into most of the sessions and rudely interrupted. I'm sorry, because there were some good conversations happening there. But one was very quiet and silent. It was really interesting to see the difference between the different groups. Some were having really deep, good conversation. I think some people have been TAing for a while, so that's been happening. So I think most people are back. Yes. Most people are back here.
Yeah. So that's great. So in the team window, so if we're looking at the screenshot that Julia's shared here, if you go into the general channel, so it's right at the top there, and select that general channel, you'll see across the top of your screen a few tabs. So it'll say post, files, notebook, Word.
I created a screenshot for it, Natalie, if you go
to amazing.
Two slides ahead. Sorry, just to see that. I did that in the wee hours of the morning.
That's amazing. Thank you. Sorry. That's great. So as Julia wonderfully made this screenshot, so files here. So we're in the general channel. That's step one. And then we select files. And then this file here is being an online TA, report back. So if everyone selects that document, that file, there's some folks already in there, which is great. And we can just report back on some of the key points from our conversation. And feel free to jump in the document, and everyone's welcome to share. And that is wonderful. So maybe share one element from that you found valuable for from your conversation.
And some of you had very silent conversations, so maybe have it as a meta reflection, like it's important to have a facilitator. Or something that you actually learned from being alone in that room talking to yourself or not talking. So feel free to share whatever that experience was like, even if you couldn't find it, and that could possibly be disorienting. Absolutely. Do you want to go back one, Natalie? Or are you going to try
sure,
and share
sorry.
The, why don't you share so, the why don't you share so the document as it's being created for those people who can't see it?
I will do that. That is a great idea.
Because it's kind of cool looking the way all these little look how cool that is. It's like Google Docs all at once, us wildly editing. So this is a new feature that we're trying for the first I'm trying for the first time. I think Natalie's done it before, to get multiple people editing the same document. And so this is great for building, for a share back for sessions. It could be great for building community ground rules. But you could probably think of other really interesting ways that collaborative documents like this that live inside your team could be used for teaching and learning purposes.
Mm-hmm. And again, when we have so many folks in this document, it can become a bit sort of unwieldy is the best word I can come up with at the moment. So sort of ideally, maybe you have one person who's taken on the role of being the note taker to report back. There might be some just sort of practical considerations for how this could work. But we wanted to allow the opportunity for everyone to see what and how they could contribute to the document. So we didn't limit folks contributions to the document as well. So there are some great things happening in the document, and this document will live in our team after the workshop is over. So you can refer back to it, which is nice. So students having limited resources for their activities, setting boundaries for availability, being kind and patient. So some really important points here: ability to offer students offline assignments when they have technical difficulties. So, you know, thinking about those different ways people can contribute and show engagement and demonstrate their knowledge in different ways with this sort of added complication of technology is really important. Being transparent, setting expectations and communications. One of the things that's, I think, really becoming obvious here is this focus on communication, and that's going to be really important. And that's part of that teacher presence, I think, that Julia was talking about earlier. You know, making sure that your students know when you're available and how they can reach you, and that you're communicating about key elements for the course. So I'm just going to stop sharing that screen in order to return to the PowerPoint. There we go. Sorry, it's loading. And every time you leave and share a different screen and come back, the downside is you have to go to the beginning of the PowerPoint. It doesn't pick up where you left off, which is a bit of a complication. But that's okay. We will navigate our way back to the right page, which is this one. Did you want to pick up here, Julia? Sorry, you're muted.
I'm just talking to myself. No, sorry. I was just commenting. Somebody actually put a question in there and I started answering it, which was a really great point. And I would like for us to that kind of question that's being put in the document. I can comment and add to that as well, but we can have a discussion about it later. But let's get through this kind of core stuff. And then when we when it's time to break out, then we can have some more questions. And this can extend through the week. We're happy to keep having these discussions. There is not one straight answer. So I just wanted to let you know, for those of you who do have Teams, that there are multiple different types of Teams sites. The bottom picture here is a picture of like the top half of what my Teams sites look like. When I click on my Teams button, I actually have like 20 different teams that I'm a part of, and some of them are course sites. That's the backpack is a class site, which means that the enrollment is managed through the registration system. And so if you're teaching, if you're a teaching assistant, ideally your instructor would have requested the site based on enrollment. You don't have to do any management, kind of like what we're doing here, which is the TA Days site, which is professional learning community, but you have to manage the enrollment. So when people are like, I'm not a part of that team, we have to manually add those people because you're not registered in a course. And so I just wanted to show you the different types of team sites. You can just go up and create a team. Anybody can create a team, and they're being done really interestingly across programs. I wanted to show you the paper that I'm working on with a colleague. And so we're using a team just for us to do that collaborative editing, that we can write our paper together. So we have a team where we meet and we have like meeting set, and that's where we're adding our content. So there's different purposes that you could be using as a grad student versus yourself as a teaching assistant. But when you're a teaching assistant, ideally you're using a class site, and the course site is based on enrollment. I just want to show you the next slide that will show just what that looks like. Yeah, so the TA Days and the class are the two main ones. Go back one. Yeah. If this has not been requested, only an instructor of record, so when on that timetable site, can request a team site based on enrollment. And I just wanted to provide that link to you. I will share these slides out so that you can reference them later. These things aren't really within your control, but you are kind of like our conduit to many instructors that Ideally, we've made contact with many instructors, but sometimes we talk more to teaching assistants. So if you're having trouble, then at least you have like this information and we can help share that information out. I did want to talk a little bit about the learning management system, and there were some questions earlier about like, what is this? How do I get to it? All of those things. So the learning management system is the LMS. At different universities, there's different LMSs. Some people use Brightspace, some people use Blackboard or Canvas. And Brock and Western are the two Ontario universities that use the open source learning management system called Sakai. It's beautiful in its simplicity, but it's also a little bit, you know, duct taped together, it feels like sometimes. But I'm a big fan of Sakai, so I don't mean to disparage it. But it is an open source, it's a community source. So a lot of universities around the world built this learning management system. And so it has some little idiosyncratic things about it. And that you can, I wanted to show you the LMS because that's actually the address is just lms.brocku.ca if you ever want to go there directly, but it is available from the Brock homepage and you've probably seen it from the portal and all those other places. And once you log in, you just use your regular Brock credentials. It's okay. Go ahead to the next slide. A lot of the asynchronous activity will be happening through forums. There are these opportunities to do small group interaction. So even in a largish class, like this is a class of 80 that has four seminars, and those seminars used to be in Mackenzie Town. If you ever have been on campus, they're like the rooms that fit 20 people. Now they're actually, the seminars are happening in these private little topics that live inside of forums. And as a student, if I was in seminar two, I would only see seminar two. So you can do it so that it's restricted access. We do have an issue with more than four or five seminars. Something like psychology has 76 seminars. And so that might be a little bit too much of a load on the system. So hopefully that's not going to be an issue for you this term, but please, we'll be probably in contact with you and the instructor if that's the case. But there are some really cool ways to foster discussion, create a community of inquiry through the use of forums and topics. If you go to the next slide, I just wanted to show you it's not just text. You can add images and audio. Here's a picture in the course that I taught in the spring where I had an assignment where I had people, I wanted them to show me what their visitor versus residence profile. It's sort of like a flip on the digital native, which isn't a thing. There's no such thing as a digital native, but some people are more comfortable and they feel like they're residents in certain social media, and sometimes they feel like they're visitors. So this student created this video and he was able to post it into the forums. And so it really provides like this more fulsome exposure. And I asked for like, yeah, just a 3-minute video. But as the introduction, people just did 6-second stories. And even then you'd be surprised at how rich and engaging, you know, 6 seconds of video can be. So it's nice to balance. Not everything needs to be text. Text is really important when you're learning to write and if it's a writing intensive course, but sometimes it's nice to balance that out with other forms. And just to the next slide, I wanted to show where that can happen. So through the text box, there's this blue button that you can see that everybody has access to this private YouTube called called Echo 360. And there's an opportunity for you to have some free software that can do screen recording, it can create videos, and it's free download. It's part of our license with Brock. So if you click on that blue button that's on the next screen, sorry, Natalie, if you can go to the next slide. So there's this blue button where you can embed Echo 360 Media. That's where you can get this menu item where you can either upload existing video files that you already have on your computer. Let's say you had made it with using some other software, or you can actually download and use this Universal Capture tool. But you could also create audio clips. And so this is all a component of Universal Design for Learning, where we're providing multiple formats. And there's different ways of expressing yourself that doesn't necessarily need to only be text. a key component of Universal Design for Learning is this accessibility. So we want to make sure that if you are going to put an audio component, that it's actually that there is some text there available on screen. When you insert a video automatically within 24 hours, there's going to be some automatic captioning. It's the automatic captioning is as good as what's happening here in this live Teams if you had turned on the live captioning. So it's about 95% accurate. It's not perfect, but it's pretty good. If you know of anybody in your class who's identified and requires captioning, then please contact us because we send it for a high quality human captioning. But for the most part, the 95% is actually really excellent. Yep. And so many of you will be doing grading that will happen inside the assignment tool. You'll be working in Gradebook. And I just want to point out that you there's going to be opportunities through the asynchronous workshops in Sakai for you to play around and learn a lot more about these tools. They're pretty straightforward, but it's nice to get kind of a hands-on clicking opportunity. But I did a lot of assignments do get submitted through here. This year we have assignments can be integrated into Turnitin.com, which is a phrase matching software. It's just a checkbox that the instructor will click off. And sometimes you will use that to determine, the sourcing. It gives you a little quick indicator of how much something has been phrase matched. So that's possibly built in. And there is another tool called CrowdMark, which if you're in math and science and you have a requirement for written assignments, you might be using that. I'm not going to go into too much depth, but that might be something that we have integrated into Sakai for your site. And we're happy to support it if that's the case. But it's a subsection. We're running it kind of as a pilot this year. So I'm not going to go into too deep of a explanation, but we are here to support it if you do hear from your instructor that you'll be using CrowdMark. Next slide. Oh, that's it. Okay, we're 5 minutes over, which is pretty great. I think actually is very impressive. So I just wanted to point out that if you have any technical issues, please contact CPI@BrockU. This flexible teaching learning has actually a lot of really interesting information, things about how you can access and download Universal Capture if you wanted to start creating videos. You're welcome to do the videos for, they don't necessarily need to be for your teaching. You can use them for other purposes. A lot of the grad courses are using them as assignments. So it's a free tool that is fairly robust. So all that information is available there, as well as some more information about accessibility and creating online modules. And now we can get to what people wanted to do, which was answer a lot of questions. About how to do certain things. I think the big question was, how do I do a joinable site? How do I sign up? Do you want to take us through that, Natalie?
Yes. So someone mentioned earlier, I apologize, I can't remember who, someone mentioned that they're interested in finding out how to do the asynchronous workshops. And it's a bit of a tricky thing. So I'm going to show you how to do that because that's helpful. For sure. So I'm going to share my desktop. I'm going to sing about it. Oops. okay. So when you sign into Sakai, this is the page you land on. This is your overview page and where you can see your calendar and all of these important things. There's a message of the day if anything's that you need to know is posted there. So there's this tab on the left called membership. And if you select that, you'll see all the sites you're currently a member of, any official course enrollments, and then joinable sites. So if you click on
it's
joinable
not loading
sites.
That. Oh, it's taking a while. It's just being slow. Sorry.
Okay. I'll pause first. Is it there now?
Yes. Now you're on membership. Okay. So you're on home, membership. Okay.
Sorry.
And joinable sites. It's okay. It just took a second.
There we go. Okay. Sorry. So we have current sites, your official course enrollments, and then joinable sites. So if you click on this joinable sites, this is a whole list of Sakai sites at Brock that you can join. So A to Z Learning Services has one. BU 101 for grad studies and other important things. But you can also just search
So everyone who registered for TA Days has been added to the general TA CPI site. So you don't have to search for ours, but you might be interested in looking into the asynchronous workshops offered by the instructional support assistants for your faculty. So if you type in here ISA, what will show on your screen, I'm already a member of all these sites, so nothing shows here for me. But when you type in ISA and hit search, and let all the ISA sites will show up and you can join. There's a button that will say join, and you can join the site that you're interested in. But everyone has been added to the TA Program Sakai site, which looks like this for you. So we have Madeline's lovely welcome video. We have important information about TA Days and some other things here. But when you land on the site, you'll land on the overview page. Slowly, computer. And we at CPI have put together a award-winning, I think, video to welcome folks to our site and to introduce the team to you. And in order to access the workshop here in our site and then also in all of the ISA sites, there's going to be a button called Workshop Sign Up. Okay. And here it will list the workshops that are available for you to sign up and participate in Sakai. Please do register, because that will help us make sure that everyone who earns a credit by participating in the workshops gets the credit. It makes tracking those things a lot easier. So I'm not going to click it because I will see. Actually, I'm in student view, so it should be fine. So this is what you'll see, and you can just hit sign up. So when you select that workshop, you hit sign up and you'll be added to the list of folks that we anticipate will participate in the workshop. And then on the left-hand side is how you actually find the workshop. So this is the what to do in the first class workshop. I've developed this one, and it has a checklist just to guide your progress and some sub pages for you to work through some content. And of course, we always welcome feedback on the workshops as well. So all the workshops across TA Days will have a feedback option as well. So if I go to the Math and Science ISA page, for example, again, you'll see this workshop sign up again, and then they have their workshops listed on the left-hand side here for you to participate in. And they've also made some introduction videos to welcome you to the site and to introduce themselves to you. So that's how you access the asynchronous workshops. And I will stop talking in order to allow for other people to ask some questions now.
So there's a question about how to share screen. We've had a couple of them now, and then somebody else had a question about the whiteboard, which is actually related. So All of you will have on your screen right now, along your menu bar, you'll see, the chat button where you ask your question, but there's also a rectangle with an arrow, which is where you will share. So if you click on that, you'll actually get a tray loading up of all the different options. So somebody earlier asked that question about, like, I want to be careful I'm not sharing something inappropriate or, accidental. And that can happen if you share your desktop. So what you will see when you click that arrow, and all of you, we have given everybody the ability to do that in this session right now. So you all can click that arrow and see what pops up. And you'll see that you can share desktop, or you can share an actual browser window, which is much more specific and allows you to, if you wanted to share your application, or if you wanted to share one particular browser, then you can choose the window. And then in cases of if you already have your PowerPoint loaded, you could actually select the PowerPoint and just load the PowerPoint. And that, if you use that load the PowerPoint method, that's when links become clickable, not clicks become linkable. So somebody's gonna do that right now.